All right. Now that we have covered the last two major topics for Project 1 and Project 0, I'm going to now declare that you are a C programmer. You may not feel like it at this particular moment in time, but like I said, we've covered all the major topics that are necessary for P0 and P1. Of course, there's a lot more that we could learn about C, and we'll cover a couple more things next time, some caveats and some things that we've been glossing over up to this point. But really, at this point, we've covered everything that's going to be necessary for this course. There are lots of other references and resources on the website, but really, at this point, the biggest thing is to just get practice. And so you should be working on the first couple projects. And if you have time outside of working on those projects, I would also encourage you to play around with writing your own little utilities. So what I wanted to do now is to take you through a small example of how you might go about doing a little program. So I want to go through a simple exercise here. So let's suppose that we wanted to write a simple version of the cat utility. If you're unfamiliar with the cat utility, you may remember this from an earlier lab. Essentially, it reads a file from standard input and prints it to standard output. We will be able to use standard in and standard out. We won't have to open and close a real file, which is nice. We're going to do this one line at a time in order to reduce the memory requirement. So we're just going to read in a line, print that line, read the next line, print that line, and so forth until we reach the end of the input. So it's worth thinking first about what the basic form of our code is. What will we need? So it's probably good to pause the video here and think a little bit about what this would look like, and maybe even sketch out the code yourself. It doesn't have to be actual code, just maybe write down some notes or open a notepad software and put together a sort of a template for what you think it might look like. Okay, so we're going to need a main function for sure. Certainly, we're going to need a buffer for storing the files, and we're going to need a loop, right, in order to read over the input. So here's our main. We have a buffer. We went ahead and declared a constant that we're going to use as the size of our buffer. And again, this is so that we can use this anywhere that we need to know the maximum size of the buffer, so that if later on we decide to change the name or the size of our buffer, we can just change it in that one place and not have to change it all over a program. All right, so there's our buffer, and then we have our while loop, and we haven't filled in the condition on the while loop yet. It turns out that we're going to be able to read in the input and check to see whether we're at the end of the input all in one line of code. And that's, it's totally fine if you didn't immediately pick up on the fact that we're going to be able to do this. But hopefully it'll become a little bit more familiar to you as you go along, what sorts of things you can accomplish in one line, what things may require some temporary variables and multiple lines of code. So we're going to have some code that we have yet to write that's going to read in a line of input and check to see whether we're at the end of the input. And then presumably we're going to store that line of input in buffer. And so inside of the loop, after we've read a line of input and verified that we're not at the end of the file, we're just going to print that line. And so that's what that line inside of the while loop is doing. And that's it. And then that's the extent of our program. We return zero because that's the indicator that there was no error. And then that line at the top again is just a preprocessor to make sure that we have all the definitions for standard I/O. Okay, so at this point we need to find a function that will let us read input, in particular text input, from standard input. So at this point we need to start looking for that function if we don't already have, if we don't remember immediately which function we need to use. So we need to go to the function reference. And I'll put a link below the video as well, but here is the function reference that contains all the functions that you will find useful in this course. There are certainly a lot more functions, but these are this is a subset of functions that is a better place to start in 261 so that you don't get overwhelmed by looking at the full reference. All right, so as we look through the file I/O options under that page, we'll see that there are quite a few of them here, but hopefully we'll be able to immediately narrow in on fgets because the description is read a line of text from a file, which is exactly what we want to do. So we click on that, and that will take us to the full documentation for this function. So let's just kind of scan through here and see what we've got. So up here at the top, we have the definition of the function. So this is the return type and all the parameters. We can see that there are actually two different forms of it. One that was valid until C99, which is what we're using. And then this is the version that's valid since C99. So this is the bottom one is the actual one that we're using. The only difference is this thing called restrict. And we haven't covered this yet, and so you might be a little concerned about that, and you might go and Google that and try to figure out what that keyword means. Basically, it just means that that is going to be the only active pointer to this variable. So we just need to make sure that we don't have any aliases pointing to that buffer when we decide to send the buffer into fgets. Similarly with the stream, but because it's standard input, there's only ever going to be one pointer. So that's fine. So we don't need to worry about the restrict keyword there. Okay, so let's look at the definition. So, or the description of what it does. So it reads at most count minus one characters. So what's the count minus one for? It's the null terminator. All right, so count minus one characters from the given file stream and stores them in the character array pointed to by str. Okay, so that's the buffer. Parsing stops if end of file occurs, that's good, or a new line character is found, in which case str will contain that new line. So that's important to note as well. We're going to get the new line as well as all the text on the line. That's fine because we're going to want to print that new line as well. So if no errors occur, it writes a null character at the position immediately after the last character written to str. The behavior is undefined. If count is less than one, well, we're not going to be sending a count that is less than one, so we don't have to worry about that. So here are the parameters. So str is the pointer to the element, or this is essentially going to be our buffer, right? This is where we want to write the data to. Count is the maximum number of characters to write, so this is typically the length of str. Which you'll remember for us is a constant that we defined. And then stream is the file stream to read the data from, which in our case is just going to be stdin, standard input. Okay, so what does this function return? So on return, it returns, or on success, it returns str. So it just returns back the same pointer that you passed in. That may seem a little strange, but there are instances in which this is useful. But what's super important here is that it returns a null pointer on failure. This is the key point here, is that if we are at the end of input, right, if we were unable to read any input, then it's going to return a null pointer. That's what we can use to check whether or not we need to keep running our while loop. So if we get null, we'll want to exit. So in other words, we'll want to keep going in our while loop while the return value is not null. So that will be our check in our while loop. Okay, and then the rest of this is just some additional text about how it sets error indicators, and we don't particularly care about that because we're not going to be doing really rigorous error handling in this case. Okay, so now we go back to our code here, and since we now have the relevant information, including the parameters and the return value information, now we can start to fill in this code that we omitted in our first framework. So we're going to want to call fgets, and then, like we said before, we want to check its return value and keep going as long as the return value is not null. So here is some code that will handle that. So I've left the arguments blank for now, but this is what we need. And I encourage you to work this way when you do this. Try to sort of get down the things that you know are going to be there in your code. And if you need to leave placeholders, that's fine. You can always go back and fill them in later. Just make sure that you leave a note for yourself, maybe in a comment, that you haven't finished something yet. Okay, so we have our call to fgets, and so now we just need to fill in the parameters. So the first parameter is the buffer. Remember from the documentation, this is where it's going to save the data. So what is that for us? Well, it's the buffer variable that we defined. So that's what the first parameter is going to be. It is a char star, right? So remember that this is an array of characters, which means that the name is going to be essentially a char star. And that's good because that's what we need to pass in. The second parameter is the maximum length that we want to copy. So what is that in this case? Well, it's going to be that constant that we defined, so buff size. And then the last one is the stream that we want to read from. And we said that that was going to be standard input, or STDN. Okay, and then at this point, our program is done. And so we would want to test it, obviously. At this point, we're done with this exercise. And so I hope that that was useful in sort of leading you through thinking about how to approach programs like this in C. If you would like some more more practice or exercise, I would recommend trying to modify this program such that it prints every line of input in reverse. So you can start with the code that we had before and see if you can have it print each line of input, but with each line inverted. So here, every line that comes in from input is inverted, and so it's printed from right to left, character by character. So that's a nice little exercise, and I think that would be useful. It's not too much more difficult than what we just did. And again, if you start from that code, then there'll be relatively few modifications that you'll need to do. But I highly recommend that you take the time to do this. And that wraps up the exercise for today.